in this episode of Art Loft, a field guide for Art Basel Miami Beach 2016.
Very, very important to have a game plan. And the way I would do it, the way I do it when I go to Art Basel, is I get the site plan first. There's a map that tells you where everybody is.
Bruno Smaldi's Rainbow Prism.
People have been projecting ideas onto weather phenomena for centuries because we don't really understand nature. And I think it's maybe the one thing we cannot yet control.
And Pablo Picasso's sculptures at MoMA.
Because whereas Picasso's paintings are scattered all over the world in public collections, private collections, countless shows, the sculpture was something that he kept for the most part with him until his death.
It's all ahead in this episode of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art.
Hi, I'm Jumaane N’Namdi, and from the studios at South Florida PBS, this is Art Loft. Hi, I'm Jumaane N’Namdi, a local gallery owner and art consultant right here in Miami, Florida. I'm so excited to join the creative team presenting this new season of Art Loft. In this episode, we look at some major sculpture installations taking place throughout the nation. And a closer look to home. We are in full Art Basel Miami Beach mode. We checked in with some major players from Miami's art world for tips on visiting the fair, must-see galleries, and basically how to approach one of contemporary art's biggest annual events.
The way I would describe Art Basel Miami Beach to someone who's not familiar with it is it's the international convening of the artistic community internationally in Miami.
The Art Basel Miami Beach is often showcasing what is the newest and latest in contemporary art today. It's vast, it's voluminous, it's there's really nothing quite like it.
The week of Art Basel is like when the circus comes to town. Everybody gets really excited.
I like to call Art Basel almost like the Olympics of the art world. All these different countries are meeting up and showing the best of the best of who they have or who is considered to be some of the best artists in their collections.
I think the amazing thing about Art Basel Miami Beach is it came out of the box firing. It just exploded immediately. We had always gone to Art Basel, which originates, of course, in Basel, Switzerland. And we weren't really sure what was going to happen in Miami Beach.
Art Basel wanted to have a fair in the United States. And so the lore goes that they were looking at other communities around the country. And when they came to Miami Beach, again, it was the local community who was so supportive of having the show come here and making it all happen, that was a big factor in choosing to hold the show in Miami Beach. We have three different selection committees for each show. Any gallery can apply to any show. The galleries apply to the various sectors of the show. The sectors are galleries, Nova, positions, survey. The selection committee is from all over the world again, galleries that we've chosen to represent the various regions. For this upcoming show, we had close to 700 applications for 239 galleries that were accepted, just to give you an idea.
The fair is divided into different what they call sectors. So for example, one corner of the fair is called Art Positions, and that's dedicated to site-specific installation art, installations that are a lot more eye-catching and immersive, so that for the viewer, they're really like meant for to surround you or to be something that you could walk into. And one corner of the fair, for example, is Art Nova. So that Art Nova features the most emerging galleries, some of the younger galleries that maybe haven't been to Art Basel before.
But one of the things I always gravitate toward is the survey section. And that's a series of galleries that are showing work by artists pre-2000. So these are pretty senior artists already. Gallery section is really the main section where there's literally like 193 galleries there.
galleries sector are representing works of art from their gallery program.
They have art film outdoors, and which you don't even have to have a ticket to access. That's one of the free events, as well as art public. They screen films that are short films and video art that's made by the artist from the galleries in the convention center.
We have the public sector, which is large-scale sculpture that is in Collins Park.
So they have outdoor art where artists made pieces specifically for Miami to be on view for a while that are outdoors, installed outdoors for the public.
This edition in 2016, we will continue our talks and conversations program. We always begin our conversations program with an artist who we present as a first of our conversations. And then our talks or salon program is an ongoing program that is touching on some of the most pressing issues of today or interesting comments that the art world can bring to our visitors.
So when you go to Art Basel for the first time, it can be very intimidating. You walk in, the lights are bright, every picture on every wall is lit up to shine and look perfect.
The fair is several hundred galleries, and so to see all these works, it's really best to go early in the day and spend as much time as possible.
Very, very important to have a game plan. And the way I would do it, the way I do do it when I go to Art Basel, is I get the site plan first. There's a map that tells you where everybody is. But in addition to telling you where everybody is, it tells you where kind of the nodal points are, the various things that are going on. So if you think of the fair as a series of concentric circles, that's how you'll best understand how it works. So in the center of the fair, that first ring of galleries, those are all the big dogs. Those are the very special galleries, so the David's Verners of the world, the White Cubes of the world, those kinds of dealers. And so those are the places where the big collectors both show up on Wednesday and gravitate to immediately.
In the corners of the fair, they actually have the most emerging artists at the fair. So that's where I really feel like is some of the best place to spend your time.
I basically go around the perimeter. And the reason I go around the perimeter is because a lot of the smaller galleries, younger galleries, that have artists that maybe aren't as well known, that are experimenting more, it's fresher. I get to, you know, really find out, you know, and discover new work that maybe I haven't seen, or artists that I am following that are really just, you know, experimenting, and I think it's really exciting for me.
There's probably going to be somewhere around 5,000 works of art in the convention hall over the week.
If possible, I would actually recommend to go on multiple days.
Dealers rehang and put new things up every day as things sell.
And so you can get a new perspective in some cases from different galleries, from works that you may have not had seen that were in the storage closet behind the gallery booths. So I think that's something that a lot of people don't know about. And I think that's sort of interesting that it's sort of it's like an organism, it's always changing.
Art Basel can be very overwhelming and exhausting. So first of all, wear comfortable shoes, because some people go just wanting to be seen. They come in high heels and they're done in 15 minutes, or they're exhausted after an hour. If you're truly there to see the art, you know, wear something comfortable. Sometimes people get distracted by the really large spectacle of some of the pieces that are larger in the aisles, and they miss a lot of the really hidden gems that are deeper into the galleries.
So I would suggest that a first-time visitor visit our website, learn about the various sectors, and perhaps see what is of interest to them to kind of begin their walk around the show.
One more tip, a lot of people don't realize, don't touch the artwork. So and be careful what you step on, because sometimes there's even floor pieces. It's always safer to assume you're not supposed to touch the artwork unless you're instructed to do so.
For this year's show, we have 239 galleries that are exhibiting from 29 countries.
So you can meet gallerists from every country in South America, every country in Asia, and just about every country in Europe.
And so we have a very large international mix of gallerists and collectors and visitors who are coming to the show every year.
I love to walk and turn a corner and see a piece of art that I've never seen before and kind of be dazzled by it and go up to the dealer and say, hey, who's that? What's it about?
A really amazing opportunity to meet so many people who are so heavily invested in contemporary art, and many of these people can teach you so much, and these are people that you can build meaningful relationships with.
There are two additions this year that if I were going to the fair are people I would pay close attention to. One is the Altman Siegel Gallery in San Francisco, and it's run by a woman named Claudia Altman Siegel, and I have been following her eye for many, many years, and she has a great eye. It's her first time in Art Basel, and I know she's gonna bring it.
A great gallery whose program I follow, which is called Essex Street out of New York. So I'm interested to maybe hope to see some of what they bring of these artists' work. Within the more established galleries, I always enjoy coming across I8 out of Iceland. And those were one of the galleries that I first just stumbled upon. And I just walked into there and it was just great, great work. And they never disappoint.
Out of Los Angeles, there's a gallery called Cherry and Martin. And again, they've been representing really interesting young artists doing thoughtful things, and I'm anxious to see what they bring.
Art Basel has partners with various sponsors who are interested in bringing projects to the public as well. So in the past, we had Audemars Piguet hosting an event with the Strand Beasts, which was on the beach and an interactive display. This year, Audemars Piguet is bringing Sun Jun, Reconstruction of the Universe is the title of the project. And that will also be a very exciting moment for visitors to see a very great project on the beach.
Going to something like Art Basel Miami Beach is sort of this adventure in like discovery of how you can take apart like all of these colors and all of these materials and all of these traditions and re-examine them. I think you need to really go with like a clean slate, an open mind, and just sort of, you know, allow yourself to be moved and affected and impressed or not impressed or shaken or, you know, I mean, but it's really a discovery process. And I find that sometimes people approach contemporary art with these, preconceived notions as to what art should be. And, you know, the main thing about art is that nothing should be anything, and that everything that is questionable. And I think that that's what has always attracted me to make artwork, which is that, you know, question everything, always.
We never really thought of ourselves as a cultural place, if you will. And Art Basel has reminded us that there is artistic greatness here in the collections, in the artists, in the institutions. And that's been a really wonderful thing for the community.
Coming up on Art Loft.
In the fall of 1912, Picasso wrote to his friend George Braque to say he was in the process of imagining a guitar. And it seems very likely that the guitar he was in the process of imagining is the cardboard guitar.
Next up, we head to Colorado. No, we're not skiing, we're chilling. We're looking for rainbows. And thanks to Rocky Mountain PBS, we have a wonderful profile on Dutch artist Benno Smeldy, who is making our dreams come true. During his residency at the Bodor Museum of Contemporary Art and the Swoon Art House, Smeldy teamed up with an optics scientist to develop a large-scale prism that refracts light on a monumental scale. In other words, he went ahead and made his own rainbow.
My name is Bernard Smeldy. I'm a visual artist. I make installations and sculptures, often reacting to my surrounding and architecture and history, for instance. People have been projecting ideas onto weather phenomena for centuries because we don't really understand nature, and I think it's maybe the one thing we cannot yet control. And there's something ungraspable about nature which I think is really interesting, like all the meanings we project onto it, and I kind of like to play with those ideas. Well, I wanted to see if we could break light at a very large scale to project a rainbow onto my surrounding. And so that's what we did. We made a very large prism, and we had to have some distance as well to, and a projection screen, which was the barn.
You need a jacket.
Yeah.
I need to get a jacket. How
you
are
look
you?
Good, because you're going to be cold.
We have several labs in the Boulder area. And for us, this idea of pairing an artist and a scientist was very tempting and exciting.
It was really filled with the mineral oil. Yeah. If it heated up, it would expand and maybe it would break the acrylic.
Oh.
So he took mineral oil out and left some air in there so it could, you know, the air can be compressed, but the mineral oil, not so. My name is Stephen Tomchek, senior scientist at the National Center for Atmospheric Research. Well, I got an email from a colleague of mine, and she was looking for someone who would assist an artist who was trying to make a large-scale prismatic-type display, very large scale, and looking for someone who could help, who knew about optics and could assist the artist. A prism works by bending or refracting light. And light refracts differently at different wavelengths, different colors, as it goes through glass. And that property of the glass and the light is how a prism disperses light.
So could we aim it a bit towards the bar? Yeah, just on the...
So what we're trying to do tonight is to create a prototype display at 130 meters instead of maybe what we ultimately want to do, which is 1 kilometer. So we're trying to make a smaller scale display of this rainbow on a barn and measure the intensity of that rainbow and then use that measurement to then predict how this is going to work at much larger distances.
It was for us, was the first time to see if it will work. Initially, the whole thing we put together, Steve and I, and so I was quite surprised to see that it worked that well, and we could measure it as well, so we had a distance, we had the light intensity, and from there we could take it further.
I'm gonna go measure that, yeah.
That's pretty good. Pretty
fast. Oh-ho, 23.9.
Yeah!
That's way up. That's way up.
A rainbow is something different, actually, the rainbow in nature. It has to do with drops of water and how light refracts and reflects through those drops of water. So we're not officially making a rainbow display. We're using a prism to disperse light the same way the raindrop is dispersing light when it makes a rainbow.
Well, as an artist, I'm really, really much visual based, and often I run into these kind of with my ideas and solutions, often you run into the edge of materiality, you could say. Is something still possible? How will this work, and do I have to make concessions here? And I think scientists, in a way, they just go past that or go around that, and that's what I really like. There's also an expression in Dutch. It's called meten is weten, which means measuring is knowing. And that's exactly what we did, like on that barn. My idea kind of worked. We projected that rainbow onto that barn. But then Steve, he got up that ladder and he started measuring the rainbow. You know, and he is like, when we have data, we can take this even further. So I kind of like the idea of, so that science helps you in that way to work together and to get to something.
Next week on Art Loft.
It was a time when murals were looked down on, or maybe misunderstood, or considered vandalism or graffiti. And
It's on to the Museum of Modern Art in New York City for a look at the sculptures of Pablo Picasso. The show features 140 works created throughout Picasso's career, and these pieces have rarely been exhibited. Now, WNET Public Media brings us a VIP look into an often overlooked aspect of Picasso's long and prolific career. So unless you have a ticket to NYC, pay attention.
When we decided to organize an exhibition of Picasso's sculpture, we pretty immediately came to the realization that the sculpture is quite unfamiliar, because whereas Picasso's paintings are scattered all over the world in public collections, private collections, countless shows, the sculpture was something that he kept for the most part with him until his death. The approach we used for organizing the presentation of the exhibition was really taking our lead from Picasso. There are these absolute chapters with which he approached sculpture, and that in chronological order, one could go from gallery to gallery and see, here he is in this studio in this decade, here he is in this next studio in this decade, and each one involves different materials and processes. So the circuit through the show has you doing the experimentation just as Picasso is. And I think that's part of the fun of walking through it. He was surprising himself each new phase, and he's surprising you as well.
In the fall of 1912, Picasso wrote to his friend George Brock to say he was in the process of imagining a guitar. And it seems very likely that the guitar he was in the process of imagining is the cardboard guitar that is in MoMA's collection and that we're looking at here. The breakthrough that this object represents was that he didn't need a special studio to make sculpture. He didn't need special materials. He didn't need special tools. He didn't need special techniques. With everyday objects and common commercial materials like cardboard, in this case, and string, and very simple actions like cutting and folding and pinning and stitching, he could concoct, right, a sculpture out of that. And so the cardboard guitar is the very first of that moment of realization. You know, in the first gallery of the show, you're still looking basically at figures, which is a classic time-honored sculptural subject. Monumental figures even, and things that have a core or that are solid, that are modeled or carved. And with the guitar, all of a sudden here is this humble, everyday, still life subject that has become the focus, the star attraction, the everyday for making a sculptural object. And in a way that is constructed from disparate parts, and it also introduces space or air into the body of a sculpture for the very first time. And that is just absolutely unprecedented. And it sort of opens a whole world up for Picasso's sculpture, because once you let the space of the world in, then all sorts of objects can follow, and so can construction and assemblage and so on. And that is the beginning, really, of avant-garde sculpture in the 20th century. Head of a Warrior was made in 1933, and it is one of a number of monumental figures in the round that Picasso made in his own very first sculpture studio. And it is one of a whole number of things that have a pseudo-classical subject, which is just so funny because he really is very caricatural, this warrior. So it's Picasso taking on a classical theme, updating it in this humorous way. And then in terms of techniques, it's a work that combines modeling, casting, and assemblage. And one of the things about plaster as a material is that it is very easily manipulated. You can model, you can incise, it dries quickly, you can add or subtract from it easily. You know, he was self-taught as a sculptor, and he likes to experiment and to improvise, and plaster was really suited to that type of approach. Sylvette was made in 1954 out of sheet metal that Picasso painted, and it's a bit of a return, of course, to Picasso's early Cubist period, because he's dealing with folds and planes and shadow and the mixing of painting and sculpture and in space, and the idea I would encourage everybody to walk around her because the whole thought of multiple perspectives is apparent at every step you take. One of the things we thought was so important with this exhibition was to position the sculptures in space so that they could be circumnavigated, because sculpture is an art that is meant to be experienced from multiple perspectives. And I think Picasso plays with that from day one.
Well, thanks for joining us on Art Loft. Connect with us on social media at Art Loft SFL and watch us anytime on the PBS app by selecting WPBT2 as your local station. For Art Loft, I'm Jumaane N’Namdi. And remember, art imitates life, so live a beautiful life. Peace.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art.